Hallelujah. I'm a soldier in the army of the Lord. Before you take those seats, greet everybody around you and tell them I'm so happy to see you. I don't know what to do. Go ahead and tell them. Hallelujah. God bless you. Be seated. so delighted to see all of you all out here. You got out here in the rain, and no matter what tried to stop you, you still made it into the house of the Lord. Isn't God good? So we're grateful for what God is doing and so glad to see you here. And as others are still coming in, we'll make sure, want to remind the ushers and greeters, we have seating up in the balcony, so don't try to pack everybody down on the main floor. Amen. That's why God gave you a balcony. Amen. So don't, ushers again, don't try to pack everybody down on the main floor. We've got plenty of seats up there in the balcony, and let's make sure everybody is comfortable. Amen. Praise God. We're glad to have you all here, and certainly to any guests that may be in the room, we're glad you're here. Well, tonight, we start out with our baptism service. We have 16. Hallelujah. 16 that are being baptized tonight, and we're certainly excited for them. I realize that there are some of you that have come with family members and loved ones, and so they're going to announce the people who are going to get it baptized, who are going to be going into the water, and you all have it set where they can hear the people, right? They'll be able to hear the announcer real well, and when you have your loved one that is being baptized, if you'd like to, you don't have to, but if you'd like to, come closer. And we'll have some brothers who will help you up on the stage, ladies, and you can go up and get close to the water and take out your little phones and all that good stuff, all right? So you're welcome to do that. It is a glorious thing to see family members come to know the Lord, and amen. So I know other places don't do it like that, but that's how we do it. You know, we have it where you can come close and just watch your steps as you're going up. You see these red lines here? Those red lines mean step. All right? That's what those red lines mean. They're not a decorative item. All right? It means step up and step down. All right? So as you hear your loved ones call, if you'd like to come up, and again, you don't have to, but if you do, you're welcome to come up. And now, if you brought 20 with you, we can't get all 20 of you up here. So, all right, so we'll take about maybe 4 or 5 of you at the most, all right? And then you can come up, and we're going to baptize these. So isn't that beautiful? 16 folks, y'all. Isn't that wonderful? We don't take that for granted because some folks aren't baptized in one. So we don't take it for granted that over these last, since we've been back in person, we've just been baptizing no less than 10 each time we come together to get water baptized. So we're grateful that the Lord is adding to his church, all right? So we're going to begin, and let us prepare our hearts for the baptism of at this time.
Center of Praise family, this is our first baptism of 2023. First up is Lena Knapper.
Isn't that beautiful? Isn't that beautiful? Our dear one, do you confess Jesus Christ as your Lord and your Savior? Then upon the confession of your faith, we now indeed baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. This we do in Jesus' name. Oh, look at that. Give the Lord praise, everybody. Beautiful, y'all.
Next up, we have Adea Brazil.
Oh, that's our baby girl. That's our baby girl. We got family members coming up. Isn't that beautiful? All right, and her mama's back there in the back. Praise God. Dear one, do you confess Jesus Christ as your Lord and your Savior? Then upon the confession of your faith, we baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We do this in Jesus' name. Oh, give God praise.
We now have Makai Haddad.
Wonderful. Beloved, do you confess Jesus Christ as your Lord? Uh-oh. Let me wait for the family. Oh, y'all were flying up here too. Do you confess Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and your Savior? Okay. Then we, upon the confession of your faith. There you go, baby. Then upon the confession of your faith, we now indeed baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. We do this in Jesus' name. Oh, come on, give God praise.
We now have Sharana Stingley.
Oh, wonderful. Wonderful. We got anybody coming up? All right. Here they come. Here they come. All right. All right. Then upon the, do you confess the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? He's looking for me. I'm right here. Yes? Then upon the confession of your faith, we now indeed baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. We do this in Jesus' name. Come on, give God some praise.
Up next is Brianna Perry.
Oh, wonderful. Look at Bree. Bless your heart, baby. Take your time. Take your time, y'all. That's our baby girl right there. Dear one, do you confess Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? Then upon the confession of your faith, we now indeed baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We do this in Jesus' name. Look at God. What a mighty God we serve, y'all.
Next is Susan Wilson.
Oh, wonderful. There she is. Susan, do you confess Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? Then upon the confession of your faith, we now indeed baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We do this in Jesus' name. Oh, come on and celebrate.
We now have Brianna Scott.
Oh, look at here. There she is. There she is. There she is. My dear sister, do you confess Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? Then upon the confession of your faith, we now indeed baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and we do this in Jesus' name. Come on and celebrate, y'all. Hallelujah.
We now have Latricia Patton.
Wonderful. Take your time. Beautiful. Take your time. Beautiful. My dear sister, do you confess Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? Then upon the confession of your faith, we baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, and we do this in Jesus' name. Come on, give God a shout of praise, somebody. Wonderful. Samantha, take your time. Watch your step. Look at y'all. Samantha brought a choir tonight. Great Lord. My dear sister, do you confess Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? Then upon the confession of your faith, we now indeed baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. We do this in Jesus' name. Come on and give God praise, somebody.
Bernadette Andrews.
Sister Bernadette. Bernadette. Look at here. My dear sister, do you confess Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? Then upon the confession of your faith, we baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and we do this in Jesus' name. Come on and give God praise. Hallelujah. That's my God, baby. My dear God, baby, do you confess Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? Then upon the confession of your faith, we baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. We do this in Jesus' name. And her dad is baptizing her. Come on, give God some praise. My, my, my. Beautiful, beautiful.
Vera Villanueva.
Oh, wonderful. There she is. There she is. There she is. What a mighty God. What a mighty God. What a mighty God. My, my, my. Y'all gonna make me shout. Glory to God. My dear sister, do you confess Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? Then upon the confession of your faith, we baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, and we do this in Jesus' name. Come on, give God some praise up in here. Yeah. Go ahead and praise him. Wonderful. Wonderful. Oh, that's Cuzzo. That's Tatiana, that's our cousin. Oh, y'all gonna make me really shout tonight. My dear cousin, my dear sister, do you confess Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? Then upon the confession of your faith, we baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. We do this in Jesus' name. Hey, come on, give God some praise. Hey, yeah. Yeah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Up next is Zakia Brazil.
There she is. Look at here. Now, I didn't know mama and daughter were getting baptized tonight. Look at God. Our dear sister, do you confess Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? Then upon the confession of your faith, we baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We do this in Jesus' name. Come on, give God some praise here.
We now have Jason Kelly.
Oh, Brother Jason. Come on, family. Come on up, come on up. Only because I told him I was gonna do this. I couldn't get in the water, but I sure am gonna touch him. I'm gonna get right behind y'all. My dear brother, do you confess Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior?
I do.
Upon the confession of your faith, we now indeed baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and we do this in Jesus' name.
Praise God.
Praise God. Come on, give God some praise, y'all. Praise him, Mom. Praise him. Come on and give him praise, y'all. Hallelujah. What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. You all heard me give the testimony this morning? That's the brother right there.
And now our final candidate is Gerald Libergood.
Come on here now. There he is. There he is. There he is. Take your time, man. What a blessing. Sir, do you confess Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? Then upon the confession of your faith, we baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. And we do this in Jesus' name. That's it. Take your time. We got you. Ah, come on and give God praise. Hallelujah. That's the last baptism. Now, let's just do this right. We're going to celebrate that these folks have been baptized tonight and have given their life to the Lord. I want anybody and everybody, I want you to give God a high praise. I want you to dance. I want you to glorify Him. Come on. Come on. Give Him a praise. Come on. Come on. Come on and celebrate tonight. Come on, let's celebrate tonight. Come on, children. Heaven rejoices over one soul. Woo! Woo! Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh God. You may be seated. Tell three people, say, what a mighty God we serve. Tell somebody else, what a mighty God we serve. Tell somebody else, look what the Lord has done. What a mighty God we serve. Hallelujah. Come on, choir. God bless you.
Yeah.
name. Hallelujah. I can't stop. I won't stop giving him praise, because he's just that good. Tell somebody around you, he's just that good. Glory to God. He is just that good. How grateful we are again for everyone that has come out tonight as we are celebrating. As you can tell, we most certainly can't stop praising his name. God is worthy of praise. At this time, I'm going to have Dr. Harris. He's going to come, our discipleship pastor, and he's going to do our presentations of our new members, our new partners who have completed the new partnership orientation. He's going to present them. And then we're also going to, should we do the baptism first? All right, let's have then the baptism candidates, those who were just baptized, he's going to present you. But while he's doing so, if you are a new partner, you have completed the new partnership orientation, would you go ahead and line up here to my left, just stand to your feet and just line up against the wall here. Praise the Lord. All of our new partners, give them a hand as they're lining up. God bless y'all. Wonderful, 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 wonderful. All right. Now Pastor Harris is going to come, and you're going to call our baptismal candidates forward. Yeah, that's it. He called you forward. Come on up. And just stand right here, if you will, across the front. Some of you can go over here, if you like. There you go. Isn't this beautiful? What a blessing. My baby girl, I'm so happy. Isn't this beautiful? My. Oh, dear hearts. Just stay in place for a moment. We just want to just speak over you and thank God you've received your certificates. And we want you to know now this is just the beginning. There's so much God's going to do through your life, and he's going to use you. You have made an open witness, an open testimony of the Lord Jesus Christ as Lord of your life. And we celebrate that. And just know that you got all these brothers and sisters. And you got all these brothers and sisters. You got about 2,200 more that ain't in here tonight that are praying for you and celebrating you and want to encourage you, be a witness for the Lord. Be a bold witness for the Lord. Tell everybody what the Lord has done for you. Amen. Stretch your hands this direction. Father, we thank you for our brothers and sisters. Thank you, Lord God. We welcome them into the family of praise. Thank you, Lord God, that you brought them here. And Father, may they now grow to be mighty disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ. Oh, Father, we couldn't thank you enough. You know their stories. You know what they've been through. You know what you brought them through. So we thank you, Lord God. Keep your hand on them. Keep using them for your glory. Keep using them for your glory. Thank you, Lord. Even this young one, God, this young one will be used of God in a mighty way. In the name of Jesus. Oh, God, thank you. Thank you for Jason. Thank you for what you've done. Thank you for what you're doing. Thank you for what you're going to do. Thank you for our beloved Brianna, God. Thank you for this baby girl here, God. Thank you, God. Thank you. Thank you for Susan, Lord God. What a blessing. Thank you, Lord God, for her. Thank you. Jesus. Come on, let's celebrate the Lord now. Let's celebrate the Lord now. Let's celebrate the Lord in their lives. Come on, celebrate the Lord in their lives. God bless you, babies. You may return to your seat. God bless you. Oh, this is good. My goodness. So glad, so glad. What a blessing. What a blessing. And look at mama and daughter got baptized. Y'all better go ahead on. Glory to God. God bless you, man. Happy for you. Amen. So happy for all of you. And y'all, this little one, God's going to use her. I'm telling you, he's already got his hand on her. But God's going to use her. I tell you, y'all better watch out for her. She's going to be used to God in a mighty way. Glory to God. Praise God. All right, Dr. Harris.
Yes, now we'll be welcoming all our new partners who went through our last new partner orientation. Let's give it up for our new partners as we celebrate and welcome them. As you come down, Sister Seal will hand you your certificate, your new partner certificate, and then you can come and Bishop Lovelace will give you your towel, and then you can go and make a line across. So some of them are not able to make it this evening. Some of them are celebrating with them online, but I will call all of their names. And the first name is Sophia Clark. Kaylin Dean. J.D. Dupree. Roland Fields. Genesis Gonzalez. Stephen Hall. Willie Hall. Stephanie Hightower. Shia Johnson. Tanya Johnson. Tanya Johnson. Tonya Johnson. Tonya, thank you. Michelle Kelso. Angela and Gabriella Meha. Drew Miles. Destiny Oliphant. Deidre Pickney. Keisha Riley. Gina Sarsini. Lennon Ingalls. Now we have a whole family. We have Christopher Sparkman, Zanetta Brown Porter, Eden Jackson, Christopher Parker, Autumn Parker, Emery Jackson, and Messiah Sparkman. Let's give it up for all of them. Family that came together. Jamie and Ramona Thomas. And last but not least, Shahira Turner. Let's give it up. Amen. Let's celebrate all our new partners.
Isn't this beautiful? Now, you all may be seated here. You all remain standing. Congregation, be seated. Let me just say a word to you. As you recall, in 1982, at Oral Roberts University, the Lord spoke clearly to me. I've never heard him speak in an audible voice, but I've heard him speak in my spirit just as clearly as though someone was speaking audibly. And he said that I would return to Sacramento and plant a church that would be called a Center of Praise and would be a place for all people, regardless of their ethnicity, their cultural background, their church background, or unchurch background. And the Lord said, there I will be in the midst of the people. I did not know you, you did not know me, but God knew all of us. God knew all of us. The majority of you that are standing up here, a good portion of you, if not half, were not even born when the Lord spoke that to me. Some 40 years ago, this church will be celebrating 34 years in October. 34 years. I want you to know that we love you. And may God use you to take Center of Praise in dimensions that we never would have imagined. May God use you. Don't let anybody tell you, well, you knew. No, no, no. You are here. You are here. And I pray God will use you to do things that have not been done before. That God will use you to carry this church into another dimension. And know that you've got all these folks and a whole other group of people that are praying for you. And we love you. Stretch your hands this way, beloved. Let them hear you blessing them and speaking praise and blessing over them. We give you praise, oh God. We thank you for our sisters and our brothers. We receive them with thanksgiving. We thank you for the Center of Praise, the place of redemption, justice, empowerment for all people. We love you and we give you honor. In Jesus' name, amen. Give God a high praise. Come on, give God a high praise. God bless you, beloved. You may be seated. God bless you. Praise God. God bless you all. Oh, that's a beautiful group of people. Beautiful group of people. All right. Wow. We're growing, y'all, more and more. Hallelujah. God is adding to his church, and we're very, very grateful. At this time, we're going to prepare our hearts to pray for those who are in need of healing. You're wanting to receive your healing. If the ministers would position yourselves quickly, let us do so expeditiously in order. And we're going to pray for those who want to be healed, those who need healing. And ministers, if you pay careful attention to me, we are not going to belabor this and be here all night. So I want you to pray for folks, pray and release them. Amen. Speak over them and release them into their healing. Amen. Some people, and I don't mean that to be funny, some folk think it takes a 10-minute, 15-minute prayer. It doesn't always take that. It just takes declaring the word of faith, and it declares, and the person who's receiving the healing just says, I receive in the name of the Lord. Amen. So we're not going to be here all night. We're going to believe, receive, be healed. Glory to God. Go home and get that doctor's report this week saying all is clear. Glory to God. Amen. So if you're here tonight and you need healing in your body, maybe you're standing in proxy for somebody that needs healing in their body. I want you to stand to your feet right there. Just stand to your feet right where you are. Stand to your feet. Let me see who you are. You needing healing in your body or you're standing in proxy for someone who needs healing in their body. Glory to God. Glory to God. Amen. Amen. Wonderful. Wonderful. Now, we have several that are standing. We have several of you that are standing in the aisles. This is how we have to do this, because we've got so many that are in the room, and we want to make sure that everyone that is standing has been touched, and everyone that is standing has someone that is praying for you. So I want the ministers to do this for me. I want you to, several of you, to go down into the side aisles. Some of you go into the middle aisle. And if you see any of these ministers who are standing here around your section, they're going to be spread out throughout the auditorium. Go to them, and they're going to pray for you right now. They're going to pray for you right now. Just find them. You're seeing them now. Ministers, hold your hands up so they'll know that you're there to pray. Hold your hand up, minister, so that they'll know you're open for prayer. Glory to God. Find those ministers. And while the ministers are praying, I want everybody in this room to come into agreement. Remember, we talked about this morning, that when we come into one accord, in agreement, anything can happen in this place. So let's begin to pray right now. Let's begin to pray and intercede right now. And then as you finish receiving prayer, step back to your seat and minister, raise your hand up so that people will know that you're open to pray with them. Come on, let's pray all over this room. Holy Spirit, come and reign on us. Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, come and reign on us. Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, come and reign on us. Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, come and reign on us. Worship the Lord tonight. Let's worship Him. Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, come and reign on us. Holy Spirit, let's just open our mouths and worship in this room. Open those mouths and worship in this room. Hallelujah. 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 Glory to your name. Lift those hands. Lift those voices. Hallelujah. You that pray in the spirit right there. Hallelujah. 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 When I don't know how to pray, the Holy Spirit makes intercession. Hallelujah. Out of our belly, out of our innermost being, flows rivers of living water. Hallelujah. Be filled. He kosha. Be baba kosha. He le kosha ba. Be baba soka. Hallelujah. 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 Like a river of living water. Like a river of living water. Flow, Holy Spirit, flow. Flow, Holy Spirit, flow. Flow, Holy Spirit, flow. Flow, Holy Spirit. Flow, Holy Spirit. Hey, Abaso. Hey, Abaso. Hey, Jesus. Hey, Jesus. Hey, Jesus. Oh, God. Beloved, when you're in this type of outpour and presence of the Holy Spirit, you want to posture yourself to receive all that the Holy Spirit wants to impart to you. Remember, Dr. Harris taught a few weeks ago that out of your innermost being flows rivers of living water. Jesus taught that that is the ministry of the Holy Spirit. So for every need, there is a river. For every need, everything that, there are some things that you're needing God to do.
Yes, yes, thank you, Lord.
Some breakthrough.
Yes, God.
So on this first healing and praise celebration of 2023, God would say to you, I'm setting everything in order. I'm setting everything in order. The things that have hindered in the past, the things that have blocked prior to this, the things that have stopped prior to this, that have kept you from seeing the fullness of what you've asked the Lord to do. The Lord says, just watch me now. I've set it all up. I just had to move some things. I had to wash you. I had to cleanse you. I had to move some folks. I had to change some relationships. I had to reorganize some things in your life so that there's no hindrance now. There's nothing that is blocking this blessing from coming your direction now. So all you got to do is just step on into it. Just step on into it. You are being overtaken by the blessings of the Lord. I said you are being overtaken by the blessings of the Lord. You are being overtaken. Take your seat and tell somebody that's all and that's it. That's all and that's it. Be seated. We gotta move on here. All right, children. Let us get ready. Just a few moments, we're going to have our speaker come. I tell you, wow. I guess if you could just see what I see in the spirit, it's as though there's just a rush of angels, and they got their arms full, just pouring out. But I feel this thing here. Praise of Renee. For real now. All right. See, if we keep on, we're going to be here all night. And we're going to move. Yeah, Lord. Praise his name. All right, children. Ushers, come on. Glory to God. Let's get ready. The ushers are in the aisles. We're going to honor the Lord with our offerings, our gifts tonight. If you're giving of a check, cash, or money order, raise your hand. The ushers will give you an envelope. The remainder of us will give through the means that is on the screen. We'll give through our mobile app, our text to give, our website. Thank you for those who have given through the mail. Let's give the Lord a sacrificial gift tonight and honor him for how he has blessed us. I don't know about you. I gave this morning, but I'm going to give some more tonight. Amen. This is the kind of atmosphere you want to sow your seed. Amen. This is the atmosphere that you sow your gifts and your seed. You don't ever, ever want to come and experience this type of presence of the Lord and not offer something to let the Lord know how much you love him, how much you appreciate him. We can't pay him, but you can sow into the work that the Lord has given us to do. Praise God. We're going to give, and ushers are going to serve us as we prepare to hear our speaker for tonight. Let me say a little bit about him. The speaker that is coming tonight is, for many of you, you've seen him, but you didn't know who you were looking at. He was around here. In fact, for some time, he even served in the prior congregation that was in this building. And he comes to us from Omaha, Nebraska. I didn't know there were black folk in Omaha, Nebraska. But I tell you one thing. I'm glad that the Lord has brought this young man to preach for us tonight. Now, he and his lovely wife, you all have three children? Three of them. You got a quartet or a trio. Amen. And he is getting ready. He currently serves as the community pastor. Now watch this. He comes from, if I got this right, National Baptist background. Okay? Loves God, spirit-filled, and serves currently at a Lutheran church. God got jokes, but that's just how God is, and he serves there, and God is moving now, and I'll let he say more if he cares on it, but he'll certainly introduce his lovely wife who's here, but they're getting ready to head back to Nebraska, and they're going to be serving and planting a work there in that area. Isn't that a blessing? And he is on assignment and is going to be going there. So we want to make sure that we bless he and his lovely wife tonight. Amen. Amen. Glory to God. And again, I'll have him introduce her and you all to get to see him. And he's going to come. He's going to preach. And after he preach, we're going to go home. Amen. Ain't only y'all saying, ain't no need of you saying amen loud. Y'all the one danced and shouted half tonight. Y'all. This whole section over here talking about, amen. And they were cutting up the most. Come on. Amen. So we're so thankful, though, for what the Lord is doing. Father, we give this offering tonight. We give it liberally. We give it generously. We sowed into the work of the kingdom. Those that are watching online, thank you for your sowing into the work of the Lord. You have the information that is appearing on the screen. You can also go to our website and give with those who are here in the auditorium. God bless you, beloved. We thank you, Lord, for this and your many blessings in Jesus' name. Let's have the choir come one more time. And then after the choir has come, the next voice you will hear will be that of Pastor Desmond. Come on, Robbins. One of my doctoral students at Biola University. Write some of the best papers I've read. And I'm thankful. I got two more students up in here. Where's Pastor Lavetta? She's in my class there in Biola University. Also, one of my favorite students. And then, who else did you say was here tonight? Ron's here? Where you at, Ron? Stand up, Ronald. Ronald Burroughs. That's one of my doctoral students over there. One of my favorite students. Amen. You know you got to call them all favorites, or I'm going to have a problem when they show up in the classroom. All right, children, let's continue to worship. Let's receive the choir one more time. The next voice you'll hear will be that of Pastor Desmond Robbins of the Good Shepherd Church.
Oh,
to be on the Lord's side. I'm remembering that you have about two kind of people in the room right now. You have the people who on one side are rocking and praising Jesus, and then you got a couple folk looking around like it don't take all that. And Bishop, if you give me the privilege, I'm gonna help y'all out, because if you turn to your left or your right, you're looking at a miracle. And you don't know what God has done in their life. And you don't know the hell and high water they had to overcome. And you don't know how God healed their body. And so when you look to your left and your right, you say, God, I'm looking at a miracle. That I'm seeing something in my life right now that if it had not been for Jesus, it is good to be here with you. Some of y'all are like, I don't know who he is, and that's all right. I'm like that cousin at the cookout, because we family, we just ain't met yet. So my name is Pastor Desmond Robbins. I am served the privilege of being one of the pastors at Good Shepherd Church, under our leadership, Pastor Todd Wallace, Pastor Sandy Long. It is a Lutheran church. Matter of fact, I brought one of my staff members with me, and I'm going to tell you this, we get out of church in 53 minutes. So she's been here for an hour and a half, and I see her looking like, all right, Pastor Dez, what are we going to do? So Kathleen, thank you so much for being here. We love and appreciate you. But to Bishop Loveless and his wonderful, amazing wife, Bishop, I am grateful for you. I don't think people know that not only is he my professor, he has been one of my mentors in my covering in Sacramento while I've been away from home. So, Bishop, I am grateful for you. Thank you, sir. The great urban poet, Mr. Sean Jay-Z Carter, once said, I got the baddest chick in the game wearing my chain. And if you don't feel that way, that's how I feel about mine. So, babe, can you stand up? I love you. I honor you. I honor you. We got 3 kids. I don't know if we're done yet, but that's for after the service. We're going to praise the Lord on here. To all the pastors, Pastor Kirkland, Dr. Harris, Pastor Lavetta, Pastor Phil, it is an honor to be here. If you'll stand in reverence to the word of God for me for a moment. I'm going to preach a pretty familiar text, and I want to kind of break this text down. It's only preaching 2 verses. I'm Baptist at heart, but I've been Lutheran for a while, so we're not going to be here all day. You know, it's a happy balance. It's a happy balance. I'm reading from the English Standard Version, Romans 12, verses 1 and 2. My Bible reads like this. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. You may be seated. If I had to put a hashtag on this sermon, I'm going to hashtag it, I am the proof. All right. You don't have to look any further, because I am the proof. Yeah. And this is the conversation that the Apostle Paul writes to the church at Rome. Now, maybe you don't know a lot about Paul, but let me give you a historical field trip to understand who Paul is. We have this brother by the name of Paul. Now, I like Paul. I don't know if you like Paul. Paul is a little bit controversial, but Paul has a gangster past. So if we're being honest right now, I see this conversation that Paul has. So Paul writes to this church at Rome. Now, we know this because this is one of the longest, if not the longest letter that Paul writes to the church at Rome. Now, we're not going to include 1st and 2nd Corinthians. There's possibly a third that he writes to the church at Corinth, but that's here nor there. What we're having is this conversation about this apostle by the name of Paul.
And now Paul has to start this conversation in the book of Romans. He has to give you what you would call a salutation. Now understand that Paul is writing this conversation in a place called Corinth. So Paul not only is in the presence, he's actually far away doing other things, and he's looking at a church that's a little bit corrupt. He's looking at a country in a time where they are the powerhouse of the world. They make the rules. They don't apply by any of the rules. They think they're better than everybody. I don't know about you, but it kind of sounds like America. And so Paul writes to this country. He writes to this specific church, and now understand they are smart. Understand they have power. And so Paul writes to this church at Rome. And so he starts the conversation in the beginning, and he lays out who he is. And so throughout this, you have Paul talking about a topic of what does it mean to be righteous. He talks about his righteousness. He talks about these conversations that Paul has to have. And so Paul is going in on this conversation, writing to them, telling them all the things about how they're really not better than anybody else. This is the conversation that Paul is writing. Because, mind you, being from Rome during biblical times, you got a little bit more access. You had a little bit more privilege. It was the person that walked a little bit higher because they thought they were better based on their access and based on their location and destination. This is where we are at in this wonderful text. And so now you see him having this conversation. And so Paul, in his salutation, has to establish two things. He says, I have to establish divine connectivity, meaning I'm going to tell you about this man named Jesus who changed my life. But also he has to have something else called profound relatability, meaning let me tell you about who I used to be, and I'm going to promise you who I used to be you wouldn't like. It's like this, I don't know about you, I got a suit on because I'm preaching here and I love Bishop. I'm not going to lie to you. If you come to my church and you see me, I usually got on my Iversons and a polo. I'm telling you that's my dress up. And so the problem is, before I met Jesus, I really wasn't that good of a person. See, you wouldn't have liked the pastor Dez, because the Dez, before he met Jesus, you would have had to take the pastor off. And I'm telling you, I got some ratchet tendencies. Like, I used to trip over little stuff. So that little $20 you owe me, it's the grace of God I'm not tripping no more. Because if it was pre-Jesus me, I'm letting you know right now that little $20 wouldn't have flown. And this is the conversation that Paul is having, because mind you, Paul, back in the book of Acts. Now, this is gangster Paul. We're talking about real Paul. So Paul has to establish himself and have this conversation. Paul says, you remember back in the day. You remember back in the day where I used to make sure I used to beat up people. I was so powerful back in the day, I used to literally have permission from the government to go in somebody's house, take them, leave, put them in prison. I'm the same dude when they were stoning people, they used to put their robes down next to me so they know that I give them permission to do it. This is Paul. He's having this conversation. And so before we get to our text, you see in Romans 7, he says something. He says, I really don't understand what I do, because what I want to do, I do not do. But what I hate, it seems like I'm doing. And so Paul is saying, I have this confliction going on right now, because there's the gangster me and then there's the Christian me. And I'm struggling right now to balance both. So Paul is having this real conversation. And he's saying, I'm struggling in this, because I don't know how to balance, God, your perfect purpose for me, but it don't look like my ratchet reality of right now. So over here, I have a perfect purpose. My perfect is good. I see it. I see what you're doing. God, when I look down the road, I can see where I'm going. My problem is my right now doesn't look like that. And so now I'm at a place where I'm trying to balance everything out. And so Paul is having this conversation. I ain't even really started the sermon. I'm just telling you about Paul. I was just giving you a quick history lesson, Bishop. We ain't even in the text yet. And so Paul is having this conversation and in this writing. And so what you start to see is that in chapter 11, he ends it like this. He says, from Jesus, through Jesus, and to Jesus, all things. And then you see what we would call a theological break in the text. Dr. Harris, you know this. It's almost as if chapter 12 absolutely makes no sense. Because when we go from Romans 1 all the way to Romans 11, you see Paul having conversations about righteousness. You see Paul talking about what it means to be changed. You see Paul having a real conversation about he doesn't know what he does. You see Paul giving a full doctoral thesis on the Israelites and how they left Egypt and how they were stripping. And then we get to chapter 12. And it throws me off. Because the first thing that he says is, I appeal to you. I appeal to you. Okay, and from English language, it doesn't give us a good understanding. But in the Greek, this word is called parakaleo. And he says, so I parakaleo you, meaning that I invite you. Why is that important? Because oftentimes Romans thought that if you weren't one of them, you were never invited to anything else. And so what you saw was this thing of called separation. And so could you imagine inviting somebody you don't like to your cookout? Like, why would I invite you? I don't even like you. You don't look like me. I don't like your outfit. We a little different. And so Paul, first thing he says is, so I've given you my history. I've given you my background. You see how messed up I used to be. He said, now I met this man named Jesus. So first thing I want you to do, I want to appeal to you. So he's appealing and having this conversation. And then he says, I appeal to you therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God. Okay, this is good. I don't know. I'm like young, but I'm one of them like old at hearts. I actually like the Bible when I preach, so I'm sorry. We're going to be in text for a little bit. So you have the mercies of God. Now understand this word, mercy, akteroma. It's a beautiful word. Actually, in the ESV, it occurs 171 times, if you didn't know that. Matter of fact, it occurs, and it's different than mercy seat. This is my issue with this. It's always used in Scripture, Bishop, as a singular. It's always the mercy of God. But right now, I'm a little confused because Paul is the only one that makes it plural. So Paul says, I appeal to you. I parakaleo you. He said, because of the mercies. And I'm wondering and I'm trying to figure out why did he use it in the plural? Because you only see it here and then 2 Corinthians 1, chapter 3. You start to see this. And it's important because what he's doing is he's giving them a mind shift. He's saying there's things of your past and there's a way you think that you're struggling with, so I have to give you a mind shift. He said, so I can't just keep giving you one mercy because you used that up before you got in the parking lot. He said, I can't keep giving you like two mercies because that doesn't work. He said, you're so broken, you're so jacked up, you need new mercies. And it's the new mercies that keep coming. So every single time we're having this conversation, he said, it's mercies, it's mercies, it's mercies. And so he says, I invite you, not because you're good, not because you're cute, not because your hair is done, I see your baby hair, they looking real good. That's not the conversation. He said, I appeal to you and I invite you because of the mercies. Now we're gonna stay there. I'm not supposed to stay there, but we're gonna stay here for a minute because I don't think you understand how good mercy is. I really don't think you understand how good mercy is. Because mercy gives you something that you really don't deserve. And so mercy is saying, I am a compassionate Savior. And so it's so beautiful that Jesus is compassionate. And it's one of those things, I can't stand church folk that get amnesia like they usually didn't be ratchet. Because the same mercies that saved you is the same mercy that can save somebody else. And so what we see is the mercies. And so I love this conversation. He's saying, I appeal to you, therefore. He's giving them the history. He's giving them all the information they need. So he says, I appeal to you. I invite you based on the mercies of God. Now, let's not lose sight. This is Paul talking to the privileged church. He's talking to a privileged people. I mean, he's talking to people that most of them don't know what it's like to miss your smud bill. Yeah. He's talking to folk like that. He's talking to people that really don't have to plan to go out to eat. They go whenever they want to. Yeah. He's talking to people where their savings account has oftentimes saved them, and they felt like they didn't really need a savior. Yeah. So he's talking to a lot of check-the-box Christians, but not Holy Spirit-changed people. And so this is the conversation he's talking about. So he says, I appeal, I invite you. The reason why he has to invite you is because he said you was tripping from the beginning. Yeah, you thought you could do it without me. Yeah, you thought you didn't need me. So you start to see this appeal. But then it gets a little interesting because Paul's writing starts to kind of confuse me a little bit. Because I don't know if you know this about me, you'll know this very soon. Bishop, I'm actually not that good of a theologian. I'm just nosy. That's what makes me a good pastor, Bishop. So when I read the Bible, I'm just nosy and I want to know information. And so my problem is the Bible didn't give me a lot of information I need because he says, I appeal to you. Okay, I got that. From the mercies of God, I got that. But then the transition goes, he said, to present. Okay, present. Okay, appeal, that's deep. Okay, mercies, that's really deep. Present's like a basic word. What can I do with it? The difference is this, though, is that I'm going through a 66-day read through the Bible. That's one book a day. And so the book that most people sleep on is a book called Leviticus. You ain't got to lie to me. It's cool. I'm not your pastor. I'm not even your pastor. Don't look at Bishop. Focus on me. And so I sat down in one reading, I read Leviticus. And so in Levitical law, you have the sacrifices. And I mean, you keep reading the sacrifice, you have all these sacrifices of offerings, but the words you see in Leviticus is you have to present it. And the present and the presentation means I'm going to present it in a way that is pleasing to God. And so the power of presenting literally is the understanding of what does it mean to present yourself? It means that, God, I'm going to come with the best I have, but my authentic self. And so when you have the best you have, but it also has to be authentic. Understand in Levitical law, I'm about to help somebody because y'all been trying to figure out how Leviticus works in the whole Bible. I'm about to help you right now. Levitical law says that I give God my best. The difference is, my best and your best might be different, but God still is accepted as the same. And so what he's saying is, I want you to present yourself. Now, my presentation might look better than yours. Your presentation might look better than mine. That doesn't matter. But God said, I want you to present yourself, and I want your authentic self. I want you what you really look like. I want you to present yourself, because if you present you, all of a sudden, I can use that what's real, not what's fake. So he's talking about present your body as a living sacrifice. Now, I didn't like that either because I'm nosy. And I didn't know how you could be living and dead. That's a paradox. I didn't like the paradox. I didn't like it. And so I was reading the scripture, and it says, a living sacrifice. But the living sacrifice means that I sacrifice me and all my wants and all my desires because, God, I want you to use me for what you have for me. And the hardest part about that is that preaches well, but ooh, that's hard to live. Because remember, we had this conversation. We were talking about God's perfect purpose. The problem is when I present my body as a living sacrifice, I got to give up my ratchet now. And I'm going to be honest with you. Sometimes my ratchet I like. I mean, God's perfect purpose is cool. But have you been to the club? I mean, God's perfect purpose is cool. But sometimes I do like love and hip hop. I like it a little bit. It's a little ratchet, but I'm trying. And so you have this conversation where he's saying a living sacrifice, and it's saying, how can I give up? How can I give up things that I like, but not things that are good for me? And that's the conversation that we're having, because Paul has to write to this church at Rome. And this church at Rome has done a lot of things where they thought they can skirt the line of Christianity. They thought that I don't have to give it up. I don't have to give up all my side chicks. No, I don't have to do that. I don't have to give up those addictions, because addictions, we're good. Like, I can still do what I'm doing, and that's the hard conversation, is that when God renews you, God said, can you give me everything, not just the things you want? And so what you see is a living sacrifice. And the reason why it's a paradox in English, but a hard thing in reality, is because oftentimes I have to sacrifice the things I like and sacrifice the things that have a hold on to me, but in order for God to pursue me and give me purpose, I have to still be living. So it's a living sacrifice. It's a hard place to be in with a living sacrifice. And it's the hard thing. When we talk about living sacrifice, is that what tempts you may not tempt me. And what tempts me may not tempt you. And so what you have to do is you had to have this conversation. Bishop this morning talked about the Holy Spirit. I was watching. And you had to have this conversation and ask, Holy Spirit, what are things you need me to remove out of my life? Can you get them out of my life? Can you do it? And sometimes, instead of asking the Holy Spirit, like Bishop said this morning, sometimes we just thank Jesus. And that's hard. Because God, I can thank you and I can love you and I've seen everything you've done in my life, but then when I have that conversation with the Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, can you show me things that you need to remove from my life? Whoa, back up, Holy Spirit, get in your seat. What are we doing? I didn't want you to reveal all that. I don't want you to reveal all that. And that's the conversation. So Paul is talking to this church at Rome, and this wonderful church that from the outside they have everything together, but from the inside they're still broken because they haven't learned to be a living sacrifice. They said, I can be living but never have to sacrifice anything, and that's not what Jesus is. And so we then get to the second verse. My bad, that was just verse one. I was just giving you verse one. And so before I fell in love with theology, Dr. Harris, I majored in psychology. So I love psychology. And so I like that psychology, as you know, is the study of the human mind. Theology, theos, logos, God's word, study of God, study of religion. And so we have this, and the text tells us this: do not be conformed to this world, verse 2, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. Okay, this is my issue, is that oftentimes we like to divorce theology and psychology. We do. We like to divorce it because theology is this, psychology over there is, but this is my issue. When I divorce them, I'm forced to deal with scriptures like Isaiah 26:3. You keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts in you. I'm forced to deal with scriptures like Matthew 16:23. But he turned and said to Peter, get behind me, Satan. You are a hindrance to me, for you are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on things of man. I have to wrestle with things like Matthew 22:37. And he said to him, you shall love your God with all your heart and your soul and with all your mind. And so my problem is I can't divorce psychology and theology because I see God in both. And so Paul says, don't be conformed to this world. But what he's saying is every day I need you to put new things in your mind. And so my question for you is, how do you fill up your thoughts? I mean, in Psalms, you see these conversations where David isolates himself. I mean, if Jesus had to go to the Garden of Gethsemane to get away from people, why don't you think we do? And so what you see is this conversation of psychology and theology. And now some of y'all are looking like, okay, Pastor Dez, I don't believe you. Okay, let's do a little test. Because my theology tells me that God is good. You would agree with that. Okay? My theology tells me that God can make a way out of no way. You agree with that? Okay? But Paul goes a step further and said, that's all true. But then, to them, he makes it a little more real because he starts by saying things like this in conversation and uses example, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Because this morning, you were graced to open your eyes. So now I can see God in my psychology. I've seen it where I was struggling and all of a sudden somebody came to me and so my mind says that God has put perfect people in place. There's situations in life where you say, God, how would I ever do this? And you come to church and Bishop or Dr. Harris say something. And so that psychology is saying that, God, you're still walking next to me and you care for me no matter what I'm going through. And so what you see is my theology says that God is good, but so does my psychology. And if I can ever get the two to marry, then all of a sudden, I wouldn't divorce the two. Because if you ever been to a place you ain't supposed to go, look at me, I'm not even your pastor, I'm just visiting, look at me. Just focus on me, don't even. Them your pastors over there, I'm just focus on me, I'm just. Because if you ever go a place you ain't supposed to be, we all been there and say, man, I shouldn't be here. That's your mind talking to you. And the Holy Spirit can penetrate your mind. And so you say, I shouldn't be here. There's something more in me, and I don't know what I'm doing here. There's something that God's doing, and this is the wrong place for me. And so now we have to have these conversations. And finally, a renewed mind allows me to better discern what God wants me to do. See, a lot of folk in here get mad because you was like, man, I see Bishop up there, and it seemed like God talked to Bishop. It seemed like God come down to the Lovelace household and had catfish dinner with him. I want that relationship. But do you know the discipline? Do you know how much you gotta pray? Do you know how much you have to avoid things that maybe you like? Do you know how much you have to avoid things of the world that maybe look good but aren't good for you? And so what you have in this conversation is Paul telling them, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. He's telling this church at Rome, he's saying, this is the thing. You've accepted, so you say, but I don't see any proof in the way you're living. And if the church wants to continue to be the church, we can't keep getting amnesia. Because everybody here has a past. And so just because right now you got on your COP cute church clothes, there was a time where you may not have had clothes on you were supposed to. I didn't say that out loud. I'm sorry. Let me keep going, Bishop. I ain't gonna get invited back. I ain't invited back. We all got a past. We all got a past. And so what you start to see is the perfect purpose of God, but the ratchet reality of my now. And that's the hardest thing to balance. And so Paul is having this conversation, and he says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing, you may discern what is the will of God over your life. Let's break down will of God real quick, and I'm going to get out your way. Will of God always sounds deep. I love the Bible because in the Bible, a lot of smart people a long time ago started, like, making things a lot deeper than they really were. So you hear words like repentance, and repentance sounds scary. But then you realize repentance means how do you change your mind or your thoughts? That's all it means. And so in this conversation, we ask, what is the will of God? And this is the question you have to ask the Holy Spirit, because you got to answer this and talk to the Holy Spirit. What am I made to do? That's the will of God for your life. What are you made to do? What did God put in you that he didn't put nobody else in this room? And oftentimes, we find ourselves chasing status, we find ourselves chasing money, when in reality, we never chase God's purpose for our life. And so what do? And so Paul, in closing, says this. He has this conversation. He said, I want you to be transformed by the renewing of your mind. The reason why I need you to be transformed by the renewing of your mind is because every day you're filling your mind with negative thoughts. Every day you're filling your mind with negative things. Do you know what God wants to do if you just change your thoughts? Do you know what God wants to do if you just change the way you think about him, the way you think about people, the way you think about this church, the way you think about your city? Do you know what God can do if only you just change your mind? And so Paul has had this conversation. And Paul writes these words because he says, if you can't really do all that, don't worry. You might need an example. You might need somebody who's lived it. You might not believe the writing, but he said, you ain't gotta look no further. Because the person writing you, I am the proof. Because he said, I met a man named Jesus. And when I met this man named Jesus on this Damascus Road experience, this man named Jesus, he changed my life. He said, when I met this man named Jesus, I was broken, I was lost, I thought all these negative things about people, but when God came into my life and he grabbed me and he said, I want you to have a timeout for a minute. And some of us need a timeout moment with Jesus, where you're having a conversation and you're saying, God, whatever you see fit, I want you to use me. God, I don't care what it looks like in my life. I don't care the turmoil I'm going through. God, I need you to use me any way you can, because I met this man named Jesus. And now if I was back in a Baptist church, we would talk about this man named Jesus. I don't know if you met this man named Jesus, but I know growing up, my grandma used to say, he make a way out of no way. My grandmother used to say, he's food when you're hungry. My grandmother, we were struggling one time. She said, oh, don't worry, baby, because Jesus, he can be water when you're thirsty. All I'm saying is there's something about this man named Jesus that I get excited about, because when I think about the goodness of Jesus and all he's done for me, all I can think about, my soul crying out, that Jesus, you went on this cross, that Jesus, you died, that Jesus, everything about you was wonderful and perfect. And so Jesus, even when you didn't deserve it, they hung you high, that God, they stretch you wide, and God, you didn't stay there because you got up with all power in your hands. Now think about this man named Jesus, and I think about everything he's done for me, and I start to say, God, I thank you. I thank you that in the valleys I still trusted you, and that God, when I get to the mountaintop, I'm going to still trust you, because you're the same God that was with me when I was low. You're the same God that's with me when I'm high. Can I get an amen, a witness, if Jesus done it for you? We done. I just got a question. What do you need to do in changing your mind? Musicians, I'm about done. What's that one thing that you're holding on to that God said, I need you to get rid of that? He said, because you're living over here, that messed up, that you life. But he said, I want to get you over here to that perfect purpose. And there's something here where you're saying, God, I thought I needed a bunch of stuff. And God says, all I need you to do is change your mind a little bit. Yeah, yeah. Said, if you ever change your mind, just know that I'll be with you. If you ever change your mind, just know that I have a plan. If you ever change your mind, just know that I'll walk right next to you. If you ever just change your mind, just know that you have a friend always. And over here, it's temporary, but over here, it's forever. Said, I want to give you forever, because you're living in temporary, but the God of the universe, he said, I love you and want to be with you forever. Let us pray. God, we come. God, we come asking and we come saying thank you first. That God, that your mercies are new. That God, in spite of everything that we do, in spite of everything that we are, in spite of all the negativities, that God, you still see us and you see us as perfect and clean and beautiful. And so God, I just pray if there's anybody struggling with the thought process up here, that God, that they receive healing, because God, you're doing something in their life. God, the song says, because even when we don't see it, you're working. And so God, I thank you that you're working on our behalf. God, we'll be careful to give you all the praise, the glory, and the honor. That's in Jesus' name we pray and all say together. Amen.
Holy Spirit, give me the words that will bring you life. Words on the wings of the morning, the dark night will fade away. Speak to my heart. Speak to my heart.
God, the people of God, come on and give God a praise here. We're going to have prayer team, if you'll come, a portion of you will come to the front. We want to make ourselves available for people who have not received the Lord Jesus in your life. We're going to dismiss here in just a moment. If you have not asked the Lord into your life, today you want to rededicate your life to the Lord. Or maybe you've heard this word tonight and God has spoken to you by His Holy Spirit and you just want to be encouraged. You want that word to just sink in so that when you leave here, you'll have the courage and the boldness to walk in a changed mind. A changed mind. So that you will be proof of what the Holy Spirit will do. Proof of what God has done. When we dismiss, want you to come. Come to the altar, and these men and women are ready to pray with you. Are you glad you came to celebration tonight? Desmond, sir, you have blessed us tonight. Now, I'll just say this and we're going to go home. We'll go ahead and say yes to what the Lord is saying. But boy, you sure enough ought to be hired up on here and be here with us. So if it don't work out in Nebraska, bring your lovely wife. Y'all come stand before me right here. Lady Di, come. Stretch your hands this way. Father, we love this couple. We love their three children. Lord, it is amazing how far you have brought them. I've observed, God, and watched. Even before I really knew them, God, I've watched how you brought them through the fire. You brought them through the storm. And God, even as you're working now, you knew just what to do to get them closer to family, to get them back home with their people. And so, Lord, we just put blessings on them. We cover them, Lord God. It is a blessing to see a young couple, a young ministry couple serving Jesus, serving the Lord, loving God's people. Oh God, provide for them every need that they have. May they find by the time they get to Nebraska, God, there's things that you've already done, doors you've already opened. And we give you praise for that. We cover them, we bless them. We thank you, Lord. Bless his studies. Bless him as he pursues his doctorate degree. And God bless their babies. May they walk with you and know that a part of them, part of us goes with them. But all of you is with them. In Jesus' name. Give God praise for him, beloved. God bless you, children. May God bless everything that your hands touch. Be blessed on your right, on your left, in front of you, behind you, above you and beneath you. May everything your hands touch prosper. Know that you can do all things through Christ, which strengthens you. Remembering always, we walk by and not by. This altar is open. Please be careful. The roads are slippery. Ladies, do not walk to the car by yourself. Ask the security to help you. Get to your car. God bless you as you go. We love you.
Thank you.